almost 2 years of living and learning about COVID-19, South Africans have become familiar with prevention and safety precautions when it comes to the virus. It's been drilled into us that we should wash our hands, sanitize, wear our masks, as well as social distance. So with these measures, many lives can be saved, even when we face a new variant such as Omicron. But knowing all this, what more can we do and what more can we learn? So let's discuss this now with clinical pharmacologist Jacques Snyman. Jacques, thank you so much for your time this morning. We have gone through 2 years of navigating a pandemic, which is new to us as a global community. How do you think we fared so far as South Africans in response to it?
Morning all. Yes, very good question. I think one place where we really lag behind is vaccination. I don't think the vaccination take-up was as good as we wanted by this stage, because vaccination reduces your chance for hospitalization and death, and I think that is the aim, is to make sure that the hospitals can cope.
So now, if it's vaccinations that we have been lagging behind on, Jacques, what more can we do? A lot of times it's been cited that vaccine hesitancy or even the inadequate information dissemination process has led to many people feeling a little bit apprehensive about taking the jab. So what more can we do to give an uptick to the amount of vaccinations that are actually administered in the country?
It's a rather difficult question. I think we've got a lot of good information out there, but we've also got a lot of misinformation out there. And I don't blame the public for being sort of hesitant purely because of the disinformation being disseminated around. So my suggestion is get reliable sources, make sure that when you make a decision, it actually comes from a scientific background and not sort of a whim of somebody that's sort of an armchair epidemiologist for that matter.
Mm. I mean, many would say that you need scientists to be able to give the adequate information, but you and I both know that when it comes to the type of information that is making the rounds, that has got a lot of people actually feeling rather shaken, it's the information that is the misinformation or the disinformation for that matter. The bad news seems to be getting the most publicity. So if you have to assess the situation, what are we doing wrong and where can we improve on?
I think we need to look at what's published and what is peer-reviewed in the journals such as the New England Journal of Medicine, and not sort of go on spurious, small, unpublished studies or whims and unscientific or unfounded evidence. So as soon as evidence gets published, it's usually well scrutinized, it's well peer-reviewed, and that becomes true evidence. And I think we need to use that for the decision-making processes. I mean, just reviewing a report the other day on how the Scottish environment fared during the third wave, with their high vaccination and significant reduction in mortality and hospitalization purely due to the vaccination. So the question is this new Omicron going to be susceptible to the vaccination? And what we see at the moment is we do not see the same hospitalization rate as we've seen with the previous waves. Mm. It's a combination of natural immunity and vaccination. So there's some speculation about the virulence of the virus, but until we've got more data on that, we can only speculate on that. But what we do see is there's less pressure at this point in time than what we've seen reciprocally in the previous waves. Mm. So what we've done so far demonstrate there's some effect.
No, go ahead, Dr. Jacques.
Now, I'm just saying, so what we see is that we do have some effect of, even if we sort of would want a higher vaccination rate, we do see an effect.
Yeah. I mean, let's talk a little bit about this Omicron variant as well as how we've been able to detect the variant, right? Many would say that even ahead of the global community, we the ones that spoke out and said this is the new variant. Is that a testimony to how our science is perhaps really world-class when it comes to being able to first detect and, number two, approach it with the transparency that it deserves in being able to say, actually, this is a new variant that has come out. And from what we've seen with the results, even sometimes to our own detriment, because it looked as though the global community turned around and shunned us for a little bit before accepting the realities of Omicron.
Correct. It's almost a knee-jerk reaction from the world. So And I think that was really uncalled for. South African scientists are on par with the rest of the world. There's no difference. We publish in the same journals. We get the same peer review. And therefore, I don't think there's any difference in the scientific quality and rigor that we do practice within South Africa. And that goes across the board. We go to international conferences, we present there, and we see what our peers do, and they see what we do. So I don't think there's any difference. We as good, even and in certain areas, purely because of the disease pressure in the country, often better. When we sit with a burden of HIV, we do sequencing on a daily basis, purely because of that disease. So it's no surprise that we could do this better than the others.
We're going to leave it there. Clinical pharmacologist Dr. Jacques Snyman, they're giving us the latest in terms of how is it that we're faring in being able to manage this pandemic 2 years later.